Presently, Vishwanathan sir is the principal scientist and head of the plant physiology division at IARA, and has a total of 82 international publications in reputed referred journal, and has won several awards.
So once again, I welcome all the participants and especially the lead speaker, Dr. Vishwanathan. Over to Dr. Vishwanathan, please.
Thank you, sir. I'm Dr. Santosh Eppan, the director of Indian Institute of Spices Research, and all distinguished scientists and students who are assembled here in the very important study circle. So today I'll be talking about imaging sensor-based phenotyping of crops. So when I was contacted by the director, I was wondering what I can talk to you, because I am totally like new to the spices. I don't know anything about spices except we use it in the various preparations. So yeah. I will try to like present what applications various sensors can have in crops. I think you can look for the similarity between the crops and spices. I think many things can be applied in spices, and you can correlate it. So this is general, this statement, I took it from your Vision 2050, that you ought to increase the production of spices to about 2.7 to 5.7 fold. And in one of your document, you have proposed various futuristic research topics. I find the two of the research topic, that is smart spice farming as well as spice genomic, both will have an important component of the imaging sensor, which is emerging as a multidisciplinary science, as the director told in his introduction. So just some preliminary introduction I want to give for the benefit of the student. So when we say phenotype, what we mean? Phenotype is a set of structural, physiological, and performance related trait of a genotype in a given environment. So the very important thing is that the as we know from the school time, that is phenotype is a genotype into environment interaction. So as told in the introduction, we need to phenotype and link it to the genotype for use it for any purpose. So phenotyping is a measurement of set of phenotypes, and this is nothing new to the agriculture scientists. So from the time immemorial, we are doing phenotyping. So phenotypic selection was the first systematic approach used for improving the crop cultivation. From the time of human civilization till date, the phenotypic selection is one of the important part of genetic improvement of the crop. And the second phase, when came in the breeding or the assembly of desired phenotype. In this case, again, phenotype played very important role, mostly the genotypes with the desired phenotypes are crossed, and then mainly phenotype based selection has been done under the field condition. And then the desirable recombinant genotypes have been selected for releasing it as variety. Then the third advancement was the molecular breeding, wherein the phenotypic selection per se is not used at the time of selection, but before that, the establishment of phenotype-genotype relationship was the very key for the molecular breeding. So we do precision phenotyping, and then we try to know what is the genomic region that is contributing to the phenotype. And then we use the genome information for introgressing the trait without undergoing the tedious phenotyping process. So we know, as Dr. Santosh told, that getting genotype information is relatively easy once it became easy once the next generation sequencing technologies came in. So you can quickly get sequencing done. And I am told recently that resequencing of rice, the company people are ready to offer for 4,000 rupees. They are ready to sequence the rice plant up to 4 to 6x coverage. So genotyping is so cheaper. So we should know what is the variation in the genotype and how it is relating to the phenotype. So in that context, phenotyping is very important. We should phenotype not only the yield or biomass. We should phenotype each and every morphological, metabological, and the plant processes so that we can map various phenotypes to the genotype and use it in the breeding program. The latest advancement is the genomic selection, where the training population of the crop is used, and next generation genotyping and phenotyping information is collected. Large number of phenotype data is collected, and then you estimate the genome estimated breeding value, and then you select the desirable genotype from the breeding population based on the GEBV. So in all these cases, the phenotyping or characterization of plant is very important, and that we need to do more importantly. So not only improvement of the crops alone will lead to enhanced production and sustainable production. For sustainable production, we have to also manage our crops precisely. So precision farming is gaining a lot of momentum in these days. So precision farming is application of input, right input at the right time, right pace and right quantity. So in this case, we should know what the crop needs, and within the field, where in the location, specific location, the crop needs a specific input, then we can precisely apply those input in those places only to reduce the input cost, as well as to prevent any environmental issues related to our use of inputs. So in this condition also, the precision farming, the image-based phenotyping is gaining a lot of momentum. Nowadays, if you see the startup ecosystem in the India, a lot of graduate students are starting the precision farming, mainly by using the plant to use drone-based phenotyping, that is monitoring of the plant health, either it is the nitrogen status, or it is the water status, or it is the pest status, and then either give advisory or you give application of inputs to the specific places by variable rate application technologies. So all these things are, although it is in the emerging stage in India, in other countries where the farm holding is very larger, unlike in Indian farm holding, where already to some extent it is in practice. Early disease and pest detection and forewarning is an important aspect wherein the imaging sensor can help. Decision on harvesting is also, it is this image-based sensors are used. And again, in post-harvest grading, quality monitoring, in other aspect, the imaging sensors are used. So why the image-based sensors are gaining momentum, although we are doing phenotyping by conventional method from time immemorial, why we should use this imaging image-based sensor? One of the aspect is conventional phenotyping is laborious, time consuming and space consuming. For example, just if you want to know the biomass of a plant today, then you have to cut the plant and do drying, weighing. It takes about 4-5 days. And even late, if you want to know the metabolic phenotype, that is what is the nitrogen status of the leaf, then again you do the dry the plant, grind, digest and two things. So it takes a lot of time. So the one is the time, it consumes a lot of time and it takes more labor, and then it is tedious. So if we can do this phenotyping in a shorter time, that is you just click a photograph, and if you get some of this information, that will definitely help, because there is more time delay between the image capture and the measurement time. That is very key in case of precision agriculture, that is crop management. You want to know what is the crop status today and you want to take the decision. You cannot postpone it. So in that is why this image-based phenotyping has gained momentum. And also if you see the plant performance, that is final yield or final biomass, it can be same for various genotype. But in between, if you see different stages, what is the rate at which the genotype accumulate biomass, if you see in three cases, they have different rate of biomass accumulation at different stages. So if you phenotype only on the final biomass basis, we may not be able to know or we may not be able to combine the genetic variations that exist at different growth stages. So that's why we have to do a dynamic phenotyping, that is phenotyping at different stages of crop growth. Again, the conventional phenotyping is rate limiting in this case. So that's why the image-based phenotyping is very important. And also you have to map various component traits. What are all the component traits? It may be either morphological, physiological, or biochemical, whatever traits are there. We have to map those traits so that we can assemble and produce a genotype which is which performance is very superior. So conventional phenotyping, if we use that for genetic improvement, the genetic gain is very slow. That's why the deep phenotyping and the high throughput phenotyping is gaining momentum. It is also important to note that although genome is a constant in the plant, that is the genome sequence is same, depending upon the environment, it gives rise to various kind of omes, that is from epigenome to ionome, metabolome, signalome. So all these omes, they interact with each other, they interact with the environment, and then it gives rise to phenome. So that's why dynamic phenotyping is important to capture genetic variation and gene action at different phenological phases. That in that case also a non-destructive high throughput imaging is required. So as your director pointed out in the introduction, genotype phenotype bottleneck is a major bottleneck now to use the genome information for crop improvement. So this that's why now it is recognized that phenotyping is king. So it is very important, and heritability is queen. So if you have optimum combination of these two, then only the genetic improvement program can work faster. So considering all these aspects, the concept of phenomics, it came in 1997 when the Human Genome Project was in the final stage. In the 1997, they coined the term phenomics, and they initiated Human Phenome Project. So almost about 20 years back, the Human Phenome Project is initiated. So phenome refers to the phenotype as a whole or full set of phenotype of an individual. And phenomics is a systematic study of phenotype on a genome-wide scale. So when you have to collect data on genome-wide scale, you have to use high throughput techniques so that you can acquire the phenotype information throughout the life cycle of the plant. So towards this, the sensor-based phenotyping has evolved. So the sensor-based phenotyping, they have like some of the common sensor-based phenotyping, some of the common mechanism of the basic principles of sensor-based phenotyping is somewhat like this. When we use either artificial light or solar light, the solar radiation, when it falls on the plant, the radiation is absorbed, or it can be used in the photochemical reactions, or it can be dissipated as heat. Some of them is transmitted and some of them is reflected. So all the image-based sensors, they mainly concentrate on the reflectance, that is the radiation reflected from the crop is used to characterize the chemical and physical properties of the crop. So the other alternate sensors which are available measures either the radiation emission, that is every object above absolute temperature, they emit a certain amount of radiation, and if we can measure the radiation, we can measure the temperature of the tissue, and you know it is very important to determine the metabolic process and plant health status. And the third common type of sensors which are used are the laser scanner, wherein the laser lights are focused or emitted from the source and which falls on the object, and then the laser light is reflected back. So the time taken for the light emission to reception of the particular light ray is calculated to know what is the 3D shape of the object on which the light is falling. So in general, these are the three common principles which are used in image-based phenotyping. I'll be briefly discussing about various kind of imaging sensor and how it can useful for measure different kind of the phenotypes. So this is what I told, the common type of sensor which are used for high throughput phenotyping is the UV fluorescence sensor, or the visible sensor, which is the normal camera which we use commonly. Near infrared sensor, which measures the radiation reflectance from 700 to 1700 nanometer. And the hyperspectral sensors, they measure reflectance of radiation from 400 to 2500 nanometer. Only difference between the NIR sensor or multiplex spectral sensor from the hyperspectral sensor is that in hyperspectral sensor, the reflectance from each nanometer wavelength is captured by this sensor, whereas the multispectral sensor capture the radiation emission over a range. That is, it may capture a radiation emission from 400 to 500 nanometer, it give it as a single band. Whereas in this case, for each nanometer, reflectance is captured, so it is the depth of phenotyping is very high. Thermal sensors, they measure mainly the radiation emission, and from the radiation emission, we can calculate the tissue temperature. And the chlorophyll fluorescence sensors are used for photosynthetic efficiency measurement. So all these sensors, they can be placed in a different manner. Either we can place the sensor in the controlled environment, in the just like MRI and CT scan, they are sitting in a room and we are going to that room to scan ourselves. So in the similar fashion, the cameras can be placed in the imaging units and the plants move to the imaging unit for capturing the images, which is similar to that one we have it in IRI and NIASM, CREDA and IAHR. And it can be also, these cameras can be also fixed to monitor the growth in the field. Either you can fix it on the stationary structure like this. The camera can move in the XY axis and then they take the images of the plant which is grown in the field. So now these two are although used to certain extent, and the drone-based phenotyping is gaining a lot of momentum. So where the location is not fixed, you can, once you have the drone and sensor, you can take the data for any crop anywhere in the field. So in India, we can trace back the initiative to 2011, the High Throughput Phenom Initiative. So in 2011, under NIS of ICR, a mega project was initiated on phenomics by Dr. Trilochan Mahapatra, our Director General ICR. So once he moved to a different institute, then the responsibility came to IRA for establishing the phenomics facility. And once the NISF started thinking about the image-based phenotyping, NICRA also invested in this image-based phenotyping, and three different facilities are established at CREDA, IAHR and NIASM. In US, Bangalore also, Professor Uday Kumar, who was associated with the establishment of all these facilities as a technical mentor, he has also established a facility at US Bangalore. So in NAR system, we have these facilities. Now, once the drone technology has come, now many agriculture universities, they are also acquiring drones and imaging cameras. So now it is almost the widespread facilities are available in different places. So this is just, I want to show you our facility. This is the Nanaji Deshmukh Plant Phenomics Facility, which was inaugurated by our Prime Minister on October 11, 2017. So this facility has various facilities. That is, we have high-tech climate control greenhouses. So this one is useful for precise imposition of stresses in the controlled environment, and the image data is logged within each minute, and then as well as the temperature and environment data can be logged. And this will be each plant which is growing inside the greenhouse, it is RFID tagged. So the data is stored from the germination to maturity. All the data is available. that is the genome-wide or the organome-wide data is available. The sensors, we have all the sensors. This is one of the facility in the world wherein all the available sensors are put in. Only very few facilities have all these sensors. So we have thermal imaging, chlorophyll fluorescence imaging, and NIR imaging for root as well as for shoot, and visible imaging. And then the hyperspectral imaging. Then we have appropriate a storage system and analysis system. So once the plant goes in, these are the number of images taken. That is almost 1,234 images per plants are taken. So it is huge amount of data. So it is like you need a lot of computer scientists, statistician, and a multidisciplinary team to analyze the data. Although with the available software which is provided by the company people, you can do some kind of analysis. But still, a multidisciplinary team is required to use this data extensively. So we have also have the drone-based phenotyping system wherein we use in these drones, we use visible camera, multispectral camera, and thermal camera to capture the images. So you can, within 10-15 minutes, 1 hectare of land is covered. So you have, you get a very good phenotype data in this. So once you get the phenotype data from the drone, it can be analyzed to know for each genotype what is the variation you get. This I will show you in one of the slide later what we use this for. So now I'll briefly tell you about different sensors and their application. The visible imaging sensor is one of the very useful sensor and cheapest sensors that can be afforded by like many institute. And once you purchase a drone and this visible sensor, you can have a very good phenotyping system. So the visible sensor, it captures the image. It gives image in three different wave bands are captured. So the red, green, and blue image bands you can get from the visible images. This can be used for various purpose. That is, you you can calculate what is the projected shoot area. From that, we can calculate the biomass, and we can also calculate the chlorophyll content and senescence. We can calculate leaf area and leaf area duration. And in case of stresses, you can see how the leaf rolling occur. You can also count the leaf. You can calculate various the growth rates, and then you can measure the phenology. That is, when the plant comes to flowering, when it is maturing. All this can be possible. But for each crop, we need to establish a relational model between the image-based phenotype data as well as the predicted or the actual measurement. So these are some of the relationship or models which we have we could establish. That is, whatever the image-based data we get, and what is the predicted leaf area and predicted biomass, fresh weight, and dry weight, we can easily predict the biomass and leaf area by using the image-based phenotype. So this one is well established for several crops. Almost for most of the crop, from the projected shoot area, you can predict the leaf area as well as fresh weight. So one is the prediction, and another one is accurate measurement of actual leaf area per se. So I am not saying it can actually measure the leaf area. You have to use these models, prediction model, to calculate the actual leaf area. So although this can predict to like very high extent, it depends upon the way we phenotype, because these are the plants which are grown in the pots, and we did phenotyping in the controlled environmental condition. So wherein the image overlap and other problems are less. So in that case, you get a very high correlation. So when we do phenotyping in the field condition, then you have to see how much relationship we can establish, but we are very sure that it can categorize the genotype. That is, if different genotype have different ability to accumulate biomass, that can be categorized quantitatively. That is what we required in case of mapping. And it can also see the change in biomass with reference to field condition or input status over the field, which is also sufficient to see if in some area of the field is not having sufficient input or not. This visual image also give information, as I told, in various color bands, that is red and red, green and blue color band. And these bands can be used either the value per se or some ratios can be used to predict the actual pigments. That is, this is the relations between the chlorophyll content and the gray value which we obtain by image-based phenotyping. So we know if you have to estimate chlorophyll, which has like very good estimate of plant health and nitrogen status, we have to use either DMSO or acetone and then do estimation, which is very laborious. But the images are very useful in predicting the chlorophyll content. You can also monitor how the leaf rolls are under stress condition, what happens by using the LAB color analysis, and wherein in various light images which you capture in red, green, blue are spread across the LAB color space, and where in each bin you see what is the change in color, that is how this color is changing, and each bin the color is changing, how it is changing over the time point. Based on that, we can see whether a plant is experiencing a stress or not. In case of this is rice plant, wherein we can clearly see a particular bin, the color is changing over the stress period. And we can also distinguish different genotype, how they respond. A tolerant genotype in a particular bin value, how the change occurs, and in another bin, how the change occurs. So these values can be mapped once, which can be used for predicting the stress level in plant. Also, you can measure the senescence rate, which is a very important indicator of any stress or any other input conditions, especially nitrogen. So this is based on the visual image analysis. One of the student from computer science division, he worked on this to develop a software. So this is about to ready for use. We can also automatically monitor, that is, we need not go to the each and every plot and see what is the flowering date or what is the getting date. You can use the visual image based methods to use various image processing method to identify what is the spikes. So this is in case of wheat, we identify spikes by using the a software developed by another computer science PhD student, so which it can actually exactly detect what is spike. So this is the whole plant image, and the processed image can detect what is the exactly spikes, and it can also count the spike. So the accuracy level of detection and counting, they are very high, which is very useful for automatically detecting the phenology of plant. So this can be only these kind of technologies are developed for various crops. That is, they try to detect flowers, fruits, and then automatically it can count or at least say the flowering has occurred or the fruiting has started. So there are various methods which can be used by using different deep learning approach. Also, we can detect. So this is a different approach wherein we train the machine to remove other than the plant part, only the ear part we are, the panicle part we keep it, other parts we remove, and then later this one is counted. Whereas by using deep neural network approach, the methodologies are available wherein you keep the whole plant and then you train the machine to count only the ear part. So this we have developed along with one of the partner, which is a startup institution, which is working with our facility. We can also count the leaves or various organs in the plant, as we counted in the panicle in the wheat. The number of the leaves can be counted in the plants. This is an IIT Mumbai student who is working with us. He has developed this model for counting the leaf tips very accurately. So these are the various visual image applications. That is, you can use the visual image for predicting the for measuring the biomass, to measure the crop health status, such as the chlorophyll content or the greenness we can measure, and the rate of senescence can be measured, and it can be used for automatically detecting the various phenological stages, that is the flowering stage or fruiting stage or the maturity stage. All these can be models can be developed to train the visual images. The next important camera which is commonly available is the NIR camera. So this near infrared cameras, they detect the emission from 900 to 1700 nanometers. So these cameras are they give only single band of reflectance. That is, from it measures the reflectance from 900 to 700 nanometer, and it gives the reflectance as a single band. So in this particular range, if you see the water absorb the near infrared radiation to a large extent, so this can be easily correlated to plant water status. So if we can see, if we normally want to measure the plant water status, we measure relative water content, and it takes 2 to 3 days for capturing this information. And also a lot of errors will be there from the field. You bring the leaf to the lab, by the time some fresh weight loss is there. So that leads to a lot of erroneous measurement. So by using near infrared radiation emission, we can calculate the relative water content, because water has a very good absorption at this particular wave range. And if there is water is less, this absorption is going to reduce, and the reflectance at this particular wavelength is going to increase. Based on that, we can detect the relative water content, which is very useful in stress phenotyping. Hyperspectral cameras are the highly useful, which can detect a range of phenotype, that is from the morphological phenotype to the metabolic phenotype. And that's why it is gaining a lot of importance nowadays. And this hyperspectral cameras are relatively costlier, but once you have it, it can give a lot of metabolic phenotype in addition to the visible phenotype. So this measures radiation from the range of 350 nanometer to 2500 nanometer. So in each nanometer range, we get the reflectance reading. Hence, this is highly useful for phenotyping various morphological as well as the phenotypic trait. So in this range, mainly the color-related phenotype is captured from 400 to about 700 nanometer, and from 700 to about 1200 nanometer, we capture protein, fatty acid, and water, water starch, and various cell structure. And then raise the wavelength beyond which also capture the cellulose, lignin, and you can also capture nitrate, sugars, and various other metabolites are being captured by using the reflectance from different wavelength. Measurement of pigments is very easy by using this radiation, because you know at what wavelength the pigment has absorptions. That is, these are the important pigments, chlorophyll or the beta-carotene or various anthocyanin, any other colored pigment. You know what is the wavelength at which it absorbs the radiation. So we can use a specific wavelength to see how the reflectance is there. Based on that, we can calculate these pigments. So these are some of the examples wherein we could use this hyperspectral phenotyping to see the stress level. So this is the ratio spectral index. That is one thing I want to say, like either they, once you get large number of data from each wavelength, then this each wavelength reflectance data is correlated with the phenotype, and then you identify certain wavelength where the reflectance has significant correlation, either positive or negative, with the phenotype, and then try to develop an indice by using one or two wavelengths, or you can use multiple wavelengths also to develop an indices, or you can use machine learning approaches wherein the whole range of wavelength is used to associate with the phenotype. So this one is the relations between the water deficit stress and the various indices developed. So you can have very good relationship. It can be predicted. So these are various kind of indices you can develop by using these approaches. In some cases, even single wavelength reflectance can precisely predict the water status. As I told in the earlier slide, around 2000 nanometer, it has water has a very high absorption range. So in that particular wavelength can also be used for determining the water status, which is very critical in stress experiment as well as in the precision farming, wherein we want to manage the crop irrigation. Various other kind of indices can also be developed by using this one. That is, this is a multiple linear regression wherein we use the reflectance from the various wavelengths. So you can use various approaches to develop models to predict the phenotype. We can also use develop different kind of indices to develop the metabolite level. This what we have tried for the sugar level. Although the prediction is not as high as that for the water content, but still the prediction is about the around 0.7 to 0.8 for various sugars. By using the red edge effect, we can also predict the nitrogen status of the plant. So this is the various different wheat genotype for which we used the hyperspectral imaging, these indices, that is reflectance at this specific wavelength, to predict the nitrogen level. So this has a very good correlation. And the important thing is you can also see the distribution of this nitrogen in the whole plant where it is distributed. So these are one of the sensitive plant where you can see from the control and the stress level, the nitrogen has decreased drastically, and in this case we can see there is no decrease in the nitrogen level in this plant. So similarly, various indices have been developed to detect the nitrogen level. In addition to that, you can also use these hyperspectral signatures to develop various model to relate it with various mineral elements which are present in the plant. So this is very useful to detect the mineral element. The scientists have also used from other facilities by using this, they could detect the protein content. So this is the protein content estimation in the wheat kernel. And the important thing is you can see how different genotype they differ in the protein content. Although the genotype, they may have similar protein content, but the distribution of protein content within the kernel, it varies. So those kind of details can also be captured by using the spectral signatures. So there are lot of applications. Various indices are available. At least more than 300 indices are available in different crops for using hyperspectral image to capture various phenotype ranging from the nutrient status to the stress level. We can also use this field images wherein we capture the hyperspectral image and then we can convert them into biomass, then see clear difference between nitrogen application and the control and stress field. We can quantitatively estimate that. And this is again by using the drones, you can estimate the nitrogen related data from various conditions in the field. It's the well irrigated and plants with the nitrogen stress. So I also look whether some application I can get it for the spices. So I got some new paper from outside. This is for example taken here. So this one is detection of admixtures in the process spices. That is, this is in the nutmeg. They tried to see if there is an admixture is there, whether they will be able to detect by using the hyperspectral imaging. So this is the nutmeg powder where the grape indicates the reflectance from that one, and these are different admixtures used in that. So if you have different kind of admixture, you can take these images and you can develop a model to predict what is the, whether admixture is there or not, or what is the level of admixture. Similarly, one paper I have also seen on the detection of mixture of the papaya seeds in the black pepper. So they could also see that this is the hyperspectral reflectance pattern for the black pepper seed, and this is the papaya seed, and this is the admixture. This is for the whole seed, and this is for the ground powder. So it is pure black pepper powder versus the papaya seed powder and various range of admix. So people are trying to use this hyperspectral imaging for even the post-harvest application to detect the adulteration in the various product. And this image-based phenotypes are highly useful for genome-wide association analysis and as well as QTL mapping. And this is the relationship between the protein content estimated by conventional method and protein content estimated by the hyperspectral method, and both map to the same location. That is, if you see the QTL on these two QTL and these two QTL are same. So it can be effectively used for mapping various phenotypic traits. People are also using this hyperspectral reflectance-based phenotyping for deciding the time of harvesting. So this one is in the grapes. The hyperspectral sensor is used on a mobile platform and move through the field and then see at what stage the grapes are in maturity. You can predict what is the TSS and what is the anthocyanin content, then accordingly the harvesting time can be determined. It is also used in the detection of disease. So in our ARI, Dr. Sahu has done some work on detection of the rust disease in wheat. Currently we are working in determine the blast and various rice diseases. So you can easily distinguish different stages of rust infection by using the hyperspectral imaging. So you can see at some specific wavelength there is a large amount of difference. And also you can distinguish different diseases. This is the barley leaf infected with different diseases. Rust and powdery mildew. So these, if you see from the healthy leaf, this is the reflectance pattern. These are the reflectance pattern for other diseases. So these are being extensively used. The models are being developed, although we cannot say that at present it can be immediately used, but people are working a lot on these aspects, including several startups in India, to easily detect the disease in the field. That is ultimate objective of mainly disease detection in these cases is to detect the disease in the field. Like this one, you run a drone with this camera and it will detect the disease in the specific locations in the field. So before spreading, you can take some action to control the disease, contain the disease, or you can contain it at the early stage. We can also distinguish the genotype. This is an example in our case. We have used several large number of rice genotype we use. And we can distinguish one genotype from the other genotype based on the reflectance at different wavelengths. So these wavelengths may vary from, crop to crop. So by using these reflectance data, we can separate the different genotypes or varieties. So the next sensor I'll be briefly talking about is the chlorophyll fluorescence imaging. So this is very important and which is commonly used by the plant physiologist. So when light is falling on the leaf, most of the light is used in the photochemistry. Some can be emitted as heat and some can be emitted as fluorescence. So when the photochemistry is saturated, if we can measure the fluorescence, we will know the efficiency of the electron transport system. So that principle is applied in this chlorophyll fluorescence imaging, where a dark adapted plant is subjected to the fluorescence imaging. And this shows an example of two different rice plant. One is transgenic rice plant and another is normal rice plant. Under normal condition, this is how the chlorophyll fluorescence image occurs. And if you subject them to kind of severe stress, the transgenic plant still it can retain the electron transport system activity, whereas the wild type plant loses it. And we can detect genotypic variation, that is, we can quantify what is the chlorophyll fluorescence yield or photosystem yield under normal condition and what is there under different stress conditions. So we can use this for quantifying the this stress level, and it is also like commonly used in abiotic stress measurement, and some recently many people are also trying to use this for disease detection. The fourth important sensors, which is also commonly used both in the field as well as in the lab phenotyping, is the detection of temperature. So which is not new to the plant breeders and physiologists, because infrared gun is used for almost for last 20 years for phenotyping the canopy temperature and then associated with stress tolerance. So the camera is more effective than the infrared gun, because the camera, the infrared gun, the depending upon the field of view, it will capture the radiation emission from the leaf or stem or from the soil or whatever the field of view is there. So we get some errors in that one, whereas in case of imaging sensor, those problem is not there. Once you take the image, you can see the pixel-wise radiation emission. You can omit the soil area and you can take only the plant area. So we can detect the temperature for the panicle and leaf, various organs. We can detect the temperature. And this one is a highly accurate measurement, because it is a direct measurement of radiation versus the temperature relations. So under field condition, this can be used for determining the crop water stress index. That is, you measure the temperature of the canopy and temperature of the air, as well as the temperature of the totally irrigated canopy and temperature of the totally dry plant or reference. So based on this crop water stress index, you can calculate the crop water stress index for the plots. Like in the field, you can calculate it. And then this can be associated with the yield. So this is for different crops, different crop water stress index and yield changes there. So as the stress index increases, you can see there is a decrease in the yield, and you determine at what level, depending upon the irrigation available, you have to irrigate the field. So it is highly useful for automation of irrigation, although here it is not used. This one is commonly used in the larger land area which is available abroad. So all this kind of information can be, that is, image-based features or indices-based features are highly useful in mapping the genes and QTL. This is an example I have shown in rice. So we have mapped QTL for water use, nitrogen use, and drought tolerance. So both image-based phenotype as well as the actual measurement-based phenotype, it maps several common QTL. So it can be used in the breeding application as well as in the field application for precision breeding. So besides the image-based phenotyping and the drone application, now another kind of sensor are also coming, various thin graphene-based sensors, that is, very thin sensors, can be attached to the plant, and then the these sensors can text message the farmers that either I need water or I need nitrogen. That is, they can sense the water level or they can sense the nitrogen levels. These sensors are in developmental stage. So these can inform the farm manager that the water is needed or nutrient is needed or there is an insect attack. So these are some of the future scenario. So some of the challenges and research gaps are like the image-based data versus metabolic phenotype. So currently by using all these sensors, we could map only few metabolites and few phenotype data, but we need to develop methods for various other metabolite phenotype. And also you have to develop some cheaper sensor, because hyperspectral sensors, they although they are very useful and sensor is very costly. So based on this image analysis or the spectral analysis, if you identify some of the wave bands are important for a specific metabolite trait. So similar to the chlorophyll meter, there may be in future we'll have a lot of small handheld meters for detection of various metabolites. And establishment of genotype to phenotype relationship, it will remain a major challenge. Lot of work is needed. And the other challenge is predicting the phenotype in diverse environment. That is, we are doing phenotype in one location, whether what will happen to the phenotype in a diverse location. So in these cases, the dephenotyping as well as denurotyping results will help establish predicting the phenotype. Work is also in progress for prediction of phenotypes of offspring based on the parental phenome. That is, if parents have different set of phenome, so what will be the phenotypes of the offspring? Then phenome-wide association analysis, which is commonly used in animal sciences, which is also gaining momentum in plant sciences. Functional mapping is another important aspect. So normally, when we use QTL mapping, we associate data for one point, say biomass at the point X, and we are trying to correlate with the genome to map a QTL. So in functional mapping, the phenotypic trait captured over the period of life cycle of the plant is used together to map the genomic regions that contribute to the phenotype. And the artificial intelligence-based phenotyping and crop breeding based in the crop breeding is also gaining momentum. So whatever, like I have presented, mostly we use a method wherein we try to use a correlation analysis or the biochemical principle where the reflectance of a specific metabolite or wave band we associate with this, the reflectance from the image data. In addition to that, the whole range of the imaging signatures can be used to train the machine to see if what is the specific phenotype of the plant from which the image is taken. So when you use large number of images, the machine itself can say whether it is what is the metabolite level or whether it is control or stress condition. So these kind of applications we have developed to distinguish the plant from the control and stress. So although it is a very simple application, but the machine itself can classify the data from the facility into control set and route set. We need not say this is from the control or route set. In case of precision application, there is a lot of scope because of the drones and the UAV-based phenotyping, as well as the drone and the UAV-based the crop management system. The EC, the application of pesticide in different terrains where it is difficult for us to access, as where the director mentioned that the tree crops and other locations. So drone-based application for phenotyping as well as management may be very useful. So this is the temporal management can be easily managed. That is, you detect the nitrogen deficiency or the irrigation requirement for a particular field, and you can easily manage for the whole field in case of small farmers. In case of large farms, you need spatial management, that is between a different location, how to apply pesticide or fertilizer or nitrogen. In case of nitrogen or irrigation application, it may be okay, but whether if you apply pesticide and for disease control only in a specific location of the field, whether where we could detect in other location the pest and disease may be there, whether it will lead to any kind of resistance or again outbreak, or it may need multiple spraying. So all these aspects needs to be studied in detail. And there are several limitations, the computer vision aided image challenges, that is often you have to distinguish between the weeds and plant. Although in US large field, people are trying to use the sensor which detect the weeds and spray it on this. So where the plants are grown in rows and the weeds in between the rows, if it is there, it is easy for these machines to detect the weed and spray it on the weed between the rows. But if it is between the plant, if it is there, then it may be difficult. And same crop health condition is caused by multiple biotic and abiotic factors. So as I told, if we can use visual image to distinguish whether the leaf color is yellow or how it is going, but the same yellow color of the leaf can be caused by multiple biotic and abiotic factors. So to use various deep learning and AI application for the plant health monitoring, we should distinguish what is the cause of that particular plant health. Then only we can give precise application. So these are some of the important aspects. We need to develop sensors which are handheld, and some so nowadays the satellites also giving a lot of information, and with small pixel size, that is, which is sufficient to detect a plot level. So we have to see how these applications can help in the precision management. So this is, as I told, like since the plants look similar, but the causes may be different. So these challenges we need to address. So this is rice leaf and echinocloa leaf. If you see suddenly the image, you will not be able to distinguish. So we have to train the image analysis system to distinguish different weeds versus crop. And this same similar phenotype can be caused by different diseases. Like this is spikelet sterility, and the spike drying can be induced either by drought or heat stress, or the stem borer also gives similar type of the image. So how will be able to distinguish or identify the cause? So all these are in the process of imaging, and the people predict that future breeding will be like that. That is, in the farm, lot of gazette will be there, and they will be collecting all the phenotype information to map the genotype. So it is an important emerging area. Large number of people need to work on it, and a very good collaboration between the computer vision scientists, statistician, breeders, physiologists, and agronomists. All the scientists are required in the case of these analysis and understanding the data to harness the data for crop breeding and crop improvement. So I think I have almost completed my presentation. So this is my last but one slide. It is the question that gets you the Nobel Prize. After that, you just add lab coats, coffee, and air conditioning. We may have a large number of gazettes and sensors. So we should ask the right questions. Then only the application will be very useful. So this is not only applicable to the use of sensor. For any kind of research, we should ask the right question. So finally, I thank the NASF for funding our facility, and our IRI for providing all the help. And we have a large number of scientists from IARI, IASRI, IIT Delhi, and NRRI, many other IIT Mumbai, and many other people, they collaborate with us, because we are plant physiologists. We are totally new to the image analysis field, so we take help from various people. From IRI, Dr. R.N. Sahu is from Agriculture Physics, and Sudhir Tandabani, Hari Krishna, Ranjit Kropal, these are actually, they are working in the facility. So I finally thank Dr. Santosh Eppan, Director IASR, and Dr. Srinivasan, Principal Scientist at PME, and Dr. Shoran Arvind, the Spicing Up Science Study Circle, for giving me an opportunity to speak in this forum. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vishwanathan. It was an excellent presentation and maybe an eye-opener for all of us, how the phenotyping is important, how quickly and precisely we can manage this data, and how the phenomics has emerged as the cutting edge technology, and it is thriving as an emerging discipline. So, and it's a necessary complement for the genomics, whatever initiatives we are taking up in the genomics front. So, and I think it is time for some quick questions, maybe a few questions. Somebody, if you want to raise some questions, you can send it through the chat box so that we can address them. And any from the ISR team, anybody wants to ask anything? Kindly, please. Dr. Srinivasan, Dr. Krishnamurthy has some question.
Thank you, Dr. Vishwanathan, for a very comprehensive and very nice presentation. So I was just thinking about this visual sensors, counting of spikes. I think like your crops, it's like rice or wheat, usually everything, it is on the top of the canopy.
Yes, sir.
In our crops, like take for black pepper, so most of it is hidden inside the canopy. Whether it counts those things also, whether it will look deep into the canopy also to take the images, or
That is so the visual sensors only see all these imaging sensors, whatever we are talking of, they sense only the surface phenomena or to a certain depth. So in this case, like if we can from the top view, if it is not visible, then it will not be able to sense, unless like in grapes also when they do image, like it is, but there the cultivation method is different. They use all the sensor below, that is they mount the sensor on the mobile platform and they run into the vineyard and they can detect. But in case of pepper, I think I don't know how it can be placed. So unless otherwise it is like visible to our eyes, the visual sensor cannot detect anything. Most of these sensors, they use the surface phenomena. The in-depth data cannot be collected.
Okay, thank you. Just one more clarification. Disease detection, whether you can detect when just disease just initiates, or it takes some more time to detect.
So it can be detected with hyperspectral sensor and thermal sensor. It can be detected before the visual symptoms appear. So it can be detected, like in case of rust, we have seen that it can be detected. In case of blast also, we can detect before the symptoms appear. But these are under the controlled lab condition. So we inoculate it and then we take image and see. As I you told, like when we go to the field condition, the other challenge is that whether the symptom is visible on the top and how are we going to take image. Those are still under, we have to do a lot of research on those aspects, and also to distinguish different diseases, like multiple diseases. Like in the lab condition, we know what we are inoculating, or we know what disease it is. So based on that, we are training. So large number of data is still required, I think, to see how the sensor can distinguish multiple diseases that occur in the field condition. I think it is possible to detect the disease at early stage. But one thing is that in this disease and pest, the detection alone is not sufficient, because you have to also say, once the farmer detect the disease, he should not spray the pesticide. So we should also train these sensors, and maybe we have to use other data to see if this is the disease detection, or the disease occur in one spot of the field, how it is going to spread in the field, and when it will reach the economic threshold level, then the farmers can take necessary action.
Thank you, sir. This is Dr. Anish from IASR. I have a question in continuation with what Krishnamurthy sir has asked.
Okay.
Instead of detecting the plant per se, can we detect the volatiles secreted due to any pathogen interaction? using this hyperspectral analysis?
I think with this imaging spectroscopy, it is difficult, but people are trying to develop electronic nose for detecting various volatiles. Mainly in case people, these sensors are employed in tea industry for the volatile detection, and also in the post-harvest application to know the volatiles emitted from the storage structures to see, monitor the health of the product. But in the field condition, I don't know, I have not seen any application by using the hyperspectral sensors detecting the volatile. But the electronic sensors are available which detects volatile, maybe for one or two compound. But people are interested in developing those kind of sensors.
Hello.
Yes.
Dr. Vishwanathan, this is Rama. I have a doubt, like most of the spices are grown as intercrops.
Okay.
Under, so in this situation, whether the sensors would be helpful, because you showed one on grapes, that is okay because it's a pure crop.
Yeah.
When it is grown as an intercrop, will this technology work? Maybe in the greenhouse, fine, but otherwise in the field condition.
In the so that's what it depends upon. Like the application is, you can use the ground mobile platform can be useful, but I don't know in the the considering the terrain how it is going to work. Otherwise, people use also the ground based platform where the sensor can be fitted on the small tractor or those kind of units, a small mobile unit, and they do take image, but you have to invent some way of moving the sensor or taking image of those plants. So that those are the kind of innovation we have to do, how we can do in this difficult condition, whether to take image, like in case of the pepper grown in the hilly terrain, or the cardamom, which is all these are grown in intercrop. So we have to devise some methods wherein the sensor has to be like moved to the plant or trait of interest. So that we have to develop ourselves, because as such, in if you see in other crop, you find lot of literature, but in spices I searched, I could not get many of this application of the sensor. So maybe we have to take that initiative to design those. Maybe because of these limitations, people are not using. So we have to see how we can overcome these limitations. That's what our engineering people can be very useful in these aspects.
Thank you.
Hello.
Good morning,
sir. I am Tangamani from Indian Institute of Spices Research. My doubt is this sensors can be used for scheduling irrigation. Do you have any experience like this?
Sensors, yes, ma'am. It can be used for scheduling irrigation. We use it in our phenomics facility, but we are not using the field. But it can be used, because as I told, we can either establish a relationship, that is trough water stress index you can calculate, or you can just use the relative water content as an indicator for stress, and you can schedule the irrigation. So in the control condition it is possible, but in the field we are not using. So the thermal image based irrigation scheduling is widely used in many of the developed countries. So in India, although the water is one of the scarce and precious commodity, but still it is not priced to that extent. So people are not interested even going for the drip or the other kind of irrigation, which can also save a lot of water. So definitely it is the one of the easiest thing which can be done by using the sensor based management of crop.
Another doubt is, what about cost? That is the camera.
So that's what it depends upon the area of operation. So now we are with the farm bills and other things, people predict that in future, maybe large contract farming and other things are going to come in. So this can be sensor-based irrigation is very well, it is manageable if you are using a protected cultivation system wherein you can use the sensor-based irrigation where the cost is not very high. The thermal cameras are not very costly. Whereas if you are thinking of like each farmer can have this sensor, it is not possible. Maybe a custom hiring center or something like that, or some startup may have this application and they can just regularly spray on fly on over a village and they can get data for each and every farmer and they can send a text message that this crop needs irrigation or fertilizer today, tomorrow. Those kind of application people are thinking, but currently I don't know anybody is using this for irrigation in the field in India. In other countries, people are using it from last 10 years.
Thank you for the information.
So sir, there are some questions through the chat box. I think we will read out.
Sir,
Dr. Vishnan can answer.
Sir, my name is Sivaranjini. I am scientist from IASR. My question is there any work has been done to differentiate the produce from a different geographical location using any of the phenomic sensor? Because in spices, black pepper, like we are having a problem. Like produce from Vietnam is getting admixed with Indian black pepper and splitting to the Indian market. And how to differentiate? Is there any sensor can be used for such kind of work, sir?
I think it has to be tried. I think it is possible. Like in case of basmati rice in IRI, they have tried to use this good. Differentiate different basmati rice and as well as aging. That is, once the basmati rice is aged more, then the cost is more. So that could be done with the hyperspectral sensor. So it may be possible, but we have to try and see if we can do it. I think it should be possible if it has some physical or any chemical differences there between the spice from different location. Definitely, it should be possible for the sensor to differentiate them.
Sir, Dr. J. Thomas from PDS Organic Spices want to know whether nitrogen sensors can be used in India, like whether we have any handheld chlorometer like that.
Yeah, nitrogen sensors can be used. So handheld, the chlorophyll meters are available and that also people use it. Instead of that, at least for crop plants, based on those meters, the leaf color charts are developed. So if it is a small farmer, even he need not have a handheld sensor, he can have only the color chart. And based on the color chart, you can see whether the nitrogen status is okay or not, then the fertilizer can be applied. Nitrogen is also an easy one which can be detected based on the sensor. The chlorophyll meters are the cheaper one that can be used.
Next is the query from Prashant Tej Kumar. He wants to know whether it is possible to detect groundnut yield based on spectral data from above ground.
Yeah, that is a very interesting question. I think it is, normally the yield estimates the government does it based on the biomass. Like they measure the vegetation indices at different stage of the crop. And then based on the vegetation indices, they predict to a certain extent what will be the yield. So it can be done if there is a good correlation between the biomass and yield, which is there in most of the recently released varieties. That is, it is based on the model directly. They don't estimate the below ground part, but based on the biomass estimation, they calculate what is the yield. For groundnut, I don't know, but for other crop, even at vegetative stage, if you know what is the biomass, then the yield is predicted based on that. So the similar analogy or the similar application may be people are using it in groundnut, but I am not sure. Maybe people may be using the same kind of application. In the yield forecast, which government does, it is mainly based on the NDVI or satellite-based image analysis.
Next, Pavitra wants to know to detect the veins using visible and NIR sensors.
How to detect the vein?
Vein, sir. It's given in the chat box like that.
Okay, okay. Veins can be detected by visible sensor. It can distinguish the vein. In fact, you can use the visible image analysis even to detect the vein counting even in rice. So it is possible.
Okay, sir. So next, Padmaja ma'am wants to know the cloudiness effect. How the cloudiness affect the sensing by open field imaging technique? And what is the accuracy of the sensors?
So definitely that is the major challenge. Say for satellite imaging, all the satellite data from the Kharif season in many part of the country we are not able to use because of the cloudiness. Even if you are, unless otherwise you are doing proximal sensing, that is you are using the sensor by a drone which can fly in 10 meter or 20 meter above the crop canopy, or if you are using a proximal sensor, that is you are using a camera which is mounted on the mobile field applicator. So those things, they don't affect the data collection. See, some wavelength like the in hyperspectral, there is about the 2000 and 1400 nanometer, as I told, it has like water absorption band. So those bands, if it is rainy days or those kind of condition is there in those band, whatever data you get may not be useful. So these are some issues are there, but if you use proximal sensing, the cloudiness and other issues are not there. The light conditions can be modeled for various light conditions. What will be the phenotype or a specific thing that can be modeled?
Sir, another one question we received from Saumya Kumar Sahu, can we measure water use efficiency directly by sensor based technique?
So water use efficiency, we cannot directly measure. So unless we know what is the amount of water used by the plant for a particular period of time, and what is the biomass, we can estimate, say, between two different stages, we estimate biomass. But the amount of water use will not be estimated by using the sensor alone. We should know what is the amount of water used. So then only we will be able to calculate the efficiency, that is per unit amount of water used, what is the biomass produced. So in the controlled environment phenomics facility, we have option to daily monitor the whole plant transpiration. So in these facilities, it is easy, in all the phenomics facilities, it is easy to calculate the combine the visual image analysis and the actual water use measurement by the gravimetry method, which is followed in the phenomics facility. So only based on image, we cannot calculate the efficiency. Maybe you can distinguish different genotype, which one has accumulated more biomass or less biomass.
Any other question? Otherwise,
sir, good morning, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, the sensors are able to differentiate.
We are not able to hear.
Hello. Not audible.
Shiva, your voice is not coming.
Shiva.
His voice is not audible.
Yeah. Meanwhile, another question has come. Now, yes.
Dr. R. Chitra has asked one question, whether we can complete the entire description of particular two sensors.
What is entire?
Descriptors of particular plant through sensors.
It depends. If you can capture the image, you can map the descriptor, but I am not sure in rice, say for example, there may be large number of descriptor, whether we can capture all these things, I am not sure. So definitely if the descriptor is amenable for imaging, it is possible to capture the variation, we can identify it. say leaf angle, if you want to say, we can do it, or the count the number of leaf can be, we can then, or some pigmentation in the plant, or some those kind of any trait that is amenable for imaging, and if we can capture the image, that can be like easily done. I think Dr. Siva is asking something. His voice is not coming. Maybe some audio has some problems.
It's unmuted.
It is not unmuted, sir. Siva, you see your mic setting. See what you are using. So maybe your voice is not coming to anyone.
Yeah, there is some problem with this audio, I think.
Yes.
So, Dr. Vishwanathan, I just out of curiosity, you know, yes, any sensors available for the estimating the root mass, you know, maybe the root health status beneath the soil?
Yeah, yes, sir. That is a major challenge. One thing is that if it is in situ, we can use the rhizotron kind of system, wherein we can place the transparent tubes are placed inside the soil, and you insert the camera whenever you want to take reading. You insert the camera to see whether the root is growing or not. In this kind of application, the problem is that only we are able to place this kind of tube, like what we do it for rice or wheat in the field. You place it in few places, and it detects the root once it is coming near to the sensor. So this one we normally use in the in the field or in the pipe condition. We place few transparent tubes, and then which is a kind of indigenized the rhizotron. Otherwise, rhizotrons are available wherein the cameras are placed in a transparent tube, and the tubes are buried in the soil, and when the roots moves to that one, it can be detected. The other sensor which is available is the X-ray CT scan people use, and where if you grow the plants in pot, they move the entire pot inside the CT scan machine, and where the X-ray CT is used to capture the root image. We, in our facility, we use NIR for detecting the roots, NIR and visual image combination. But the limitation is that for those, we grow plants in acrylic pot, which is covered with black sheet, and then only when we take image, we have to remove the black sheet, and then we capture the image by the visible sensor and the NIR sensor, and based on that, we calculate the root. But these are very tedious, and it is in the field, it is very difficult to use these facilities to accurately detect the root. The cheapest one is placing the transparent tube at different depth, and you can use simple the webcam to detect the root if it has reached at that particular place. So otherwise, it is very difficult one. Many people are working on this aspect, how to detect the underground the phenotype.
One more question has come. So if there are no more questions, I think I should thank Dr. Vishwanathan for the excellent presentation and for the nice interaction. I think many people have interacted. So I assure that the recorded version can be uploaded in our YouTube or something. That's many people are asking. Thank you. And we will once again thank you, Dr. Vishwanathan. We will conclude with a formal vote of thanks from Dr. Sharon.
Thank you, sir.
Respected Director, IASR, Head of the Divisions, and the speaker of today's lecture, Dr. Vishwanathan, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. At the outset, we would like to extend sincere thanks to Vishwanathan, sir, for giving a very good informative lecture on imaging sensor-based phenotyping of crops and how it determines the metabolism of plants and different types of imaging sensors and its applications. Thank you, sir, for giving a wonderful lecture. Thank you. And also, we would like to extend the thanks to the participants across the country for registering and also for attending the lecture. And also I would like to thank all the staff of IASR for extending the support for this lecture. Thank you. Thank you one and all.